walking along the street, or you're at a party, or else you're alone, and then you suddenly dig. You're looking in someone's eyes, you suddenly realize that this could be the start of something big.
Throughout the history of television, there have been great and legendary performances captured by immortal actresses. Lucy, Jeanie, Ginger, and Maryanne are names which have been immortalized thanks to lengthy syndication runs and a plethora of streaming options for classic television. However, there are just as many characters who have fallen through the cracks of the collective memory. Sometimes it might be due to a show not having a particularly long run or missing out on syndication opportunities. In other cases, how are readings of characters negatively shaped or defined by the culture around them? So here are my top five favorite, though I'd say underappreciated, female characters from classic television. Our Miss Brooks began its life as a radio show before moving to television in 1952 and receiving a feature film in 1956. The series was a day-in-the-life snippet following high school English teacher Connie Brooks, played by the incomparable Eve Arden.
Hey, what are you going to do here, ma'am?
I teach English.
Hey, that's swell. Boy, if there's one thing this school ain't never had enough of, it's those.
In her dealings with the dreamy but decidedly boring Mr. Boynton, played by various men across the run, including Jeff Chandler and Robert Rockwell, Principal Osgood Conklin, played by Gail Gordon, and student Walter Denton, played by Richard Crenna. I've long loved our Miss Brooks, and this is particularly due to Eve Arden's dry and whip-smart performance. Despite the notable early television production styles, the character is fresh and stands out as an independent career woman in a world where so often women were seen simply as homemakers. The show isn't afraid to let her be well-rounded and a realistic woman. She does her job. She doesn't have as much money as she would like. She's a teacher, after all. And she has sexual desires.
But this time, instead of pursuing her favorite subject, she's caught in the middle of a muddle, trying to decide between a husky biology teacher who has that urge to merge.
It's a bit disappointing that she yearns for the boring Mr. Boynton, but that can't be helped. Throughout our Miss Brooks, Eve Arden brings the character to life vividly on screen. She's realistic, she's relatable, and likable. When watching classic television removed from the 1950s, we know that female characters don't always have this level of depth, and this is a huge part of why she easily makes the list. F Troop premiered in 1965 and aired for two seasons on ABC. The series followed a somewhat ragtag cavalry troop in the wild American West. The series starred Larry Storch as Corporal Agarn, Forrest Tucker as Sergeant O'Rourke, and Ken Berry as Captain Wilton Parmenter. Melody Patterson co-starred in the series as local shopkeeper, Wrangler Jane Angelica Thrift. Patterson is an absolute delight in the role.
Well, I think this whole thing could be settled if O'Rourke would just apologize to Corporal Agarn.
Apologize to him? Not in a million years.
Janie, we don't need a woman's touch around the fort.
Great little old woman's liable to solve your problem for you.
No, I'm not afraid of that because women only make problems. They don't solve them.
I suppose you're saying that I make problems for you.
Yes, you do.
Well, I ain't never going to make a problem for you, Wilton Parmenter, because I ain't never going to speak to you again.
Now, wait a minute, Janie. It ain't right for you two to get into a fight because of us.
No man's going to talk that way to me.
Yeah, well, it's about time someone did.
Agarn, you tell O'Rourke that I ain't never going to speak to him either.
I'd love to, but I ain't speaking to.
Patterson was crazily young when she stepped into the part, sources say as young as 16. Despite her age, Patterson is savvy, vivacious, and independent in the part.
Good evening, Captain Parmenter.
At ease, Corporal.
With the captain's permission, I'd like to begin dining on Jane's homemade fried chicken, homemade biscuits, homemade apple butter, and homemade carrots.
Homemade carrots?
Yes, I raised them in my garden.
We won't be long, Captain.
No, right after dinner, Randolph's taking me to pick wildflowers.
Going to pick wildflowers at night?
Yes, that's what makes it so wild.
Throughout the series, Wrangler Jane largely avoids dropping any of the painful stereotypes which female characters could easily fall into during this era. She could easily be that of the straight woman, but she easily carries the humorous material. She isn't chaste. She isn't a school marm. In fact, Jane is quite often open about her desires.
Thank you.
She's a woman who runs her own business and has a mean crush. If it weren't Wilton, there'd probably be others, but it's easy to see that Jane most is definitely gazing at him throughout the show. She's a tomboy who isn't afraid to get cute, especially when she wants to get through to her crush. Who among us hasn't done that once or twice? Westerns are a genre which can easily struggle with stereotypes, especially in this era. However, Wrangler Jane is a character who never sits back on her complacency. F-Troop is a short run and does struggle with some plot elements which have been aged particularly poorly, and I believe that Wrangler Jane is one of the more underappreciated female characters in classic television. Vegas is a new kid on this list, premiering in 1978 and running for 3 seasons on ABC. The show followed stupidly cool Private Eye Dan Tana, played by Robert Urich, as well as his associates Binzer, brought to life by the adorable Bart Braverman, and showgirl-turned-secretary Bee, played by Phyllis Davis. Bee is a character that if the show had been made 15 or 20 years before, would have been obnoxiously male-gazy. However, Bee's just as cool. Thanks to a sprinkling of women's lib, the character is a showgirl, a mother, and a Girl Friday. The only problem is that the show often falls back on making her a damsel in distress. Though, it feels more important that as a show, Vegas seems to be invested in crafting Bee's humanity.
How are you feeling?
Yeah, I'm okay. No, I'm not okay. And I don't know what to say to you.
You don't have to say anything to me. And you don't have to reproach yourself for anything any more than I do.
Oh, God help us all. I'm afraid to ask. How's Julie?
They don't know. They won't tell me. It's your spine. The blast threw it up against the wall.
Yeah, the camera does a fair amount of gazing. However, the camera also lingers on Robert Urich in these outfits, though I digress. It's a stretch to think about Las Vegas in this period. This was only about 15 years removed from the Rat Pack years. Women were dolls and dames who either performed on stage or passed out the drinks. There was little interest in who they were beyond the perfect facade they were expected to maintain. In her performance in Vegas, Phyllis Davis performs a quiet rebellion in showing exactly who this woman is behind the image she maintains. Chances are, you've at least heard of Gunsmoke. Even if you haven't watched it, you probably at least know the name. And the behemoth of Western began on radio in 1952 before jumping to television in 1955. The series had a groundbreaking run, lasting on air until 1975 and followed Dodge City Marshal Matt Dillon, played by James Arness, as he brought law and order to the Wild West. The cast was massive around him, including Amanda Blake as Miss Kitty, Dennis Weaver as Chester, and Melbourne Stone as Doc Adams. Miss Kitty is a legendary character in the pop culture pantheon. Unfortunately, as Gunfolk has faded a bit into memory, Miss Kitty as a character has become defined through the lens of stereotype.
Well, well, well. Will you look what the cat dragged in? A mouse. That's a first.
Not just any mouse. This is a diva.
Diva Schmiva. You put a mouse on the stage and your saloon's gonna be as empty as Death Valley on a cold day in June when the snow don't fall.
As mentioned in the early entry on F Troop, there are a boatload of stereotypes inherently built into the Western genre, especially when dealing with sex and gender. Miss Kitty is often defined as a prostitute who is a bit of a thing for Marshall Dillon. She's a dance hall girl, and this is how society has defined her in the years since Gunsmoke aired.
Is that right? Right here?
Yeah.
I see it.
The green grove is gone from the hill, Maggie, where once the daisy sprung. But I love you the same as of old Maggie, when
that was wonderful.
Watching episodes of Gunsmoke, it's tragic to see just how poorly the passage of time has treated Miss Kitty. In reality, actress Amanda Blake brought a real sense of independence and strength to her take on this character.
Well, Kitty.
You make me sick.
Kitty, look, there's always going to be somebody. That's just the way this job is, and I can't run around and hide. And believe me, there isn't a crowd big enough to get lost in if somebody really wants to kill me.
You're very comforting.
You've known that all along.
But I don't have to like it.
You know, maybe what I need is a woman deputy.
I'll pass the word around.
Don't you want the job?
I told you. You make me sick.
This is particularly evident when Blake is working with Gunsmoke writer Kathleen Height. Working together, these women brought this depth and complexity to the screen. Ultimately, as Gunsmoke has become a popular culture memory, the name of the series largely remains in the public consciousness, but facts have been replaced by stereotype. In Miss Kitty, Amanda Blake brought strong, independent, and complicated women to the screen each week, and her contribution to the early days of television should be remembered. Mason holds a special nostalgic place in my heart. The series saw a second wind during my formative years when Raymond Burr returned to play the fierce defense attorney in a number of TV movies. The original series premiered in 1957 and ran on CBS through 1966. Barbara Hale took on the role of Della Street, Perry Mason's faithful and unflinching confidential secretary. Ultimately, the structure of Perry Mason as a series doesn't allow for much character exploration as a whole, so it's difficult to get a feel for Della as a woman, but also for Perry and Paul as men. Unlike some other characters mentioned above, Della doesn't have a heck of a lot to do. I mean, this is a good thing as she doesn't fall into the damsel in distress territory. Though, throughout her more than 30 years playing Della Street, Barbara Hale found this woman, even in the face of less developed scripts. The cast found the humanity in these characters through their relationships with each other.
I refer you to Section 710 of the California Civil Code, which clearly states that... Della? Hey, come on, girl. It's midnight. Time you quit working.
Midnight? Why don't we just stay till tomorrow?
Union rules. Now, come on, rise and shine. I just gave up.
It's your own fault. You shouldn't be fooling around with wills and sulky heiresses anyway. Your specialty is murder.
Even as early as the first season, you can see the bond between Raymond Burr and Barbara Hale in particular and how it shapes these characters throughout the show that is Perry Mason.
Well, I thought you'd be gone.
Did you really?
No, not really.
How was the trip to Las Vegas?
Rough, any way you look at it. Boy, that feels good. Paul get a line on that long-distance call from Duncan to Doris Cole?
Mm-mm. Did hear from the little lady herself, though.
Doris?
Mm-hmm. She's in town, wants to talk to you. I
told her I didn't think you'd be back until after 10.
Where's she staying?
The Farnsworth Hotel. Can't it wait till tomorrow? You need some sleep.
Mr. Cole won't get much sleep tonight. See you in the morning.
In these sweet moments between Hale and Burr, we see just how important Della is to Mason, and in turn, the action of the story. This isn't defining Della through her relationship to Mason. Rather, it's her bond and relationship with Mason, which is most important to the story. It is this which keeps Della from becoming just another disposable secretary, which is so common in works of this genre. Instead, she's a flipping rock. She's his confidence, and I'd be lying if I said that their chemistry didn't make me ship them just a little bit.
P.M.
Mm-hmm. P.M. Mm-hmm. Pre-med, post-mortem, past medical. Past midnight. Yeah, past midnight. Oh, not another...
No, this isn't tea. I made you a fresh pot of cocoa.
Cocoa?
Mm-hmm.
Cocoa? I haven't had cocoa since I was a boy.
So?
So? Mm-hmm. I've been waiting a long time.
Through the history of the early years of television shows a host of fun, memorable, and realistic women on television screens. Unfortunately, the passage of time and inherent changes in viewing habits have pulled some of these names and faces back from popular culture. However, there's so much television history to continue to explore, and with that, better understand the history of the middle of the 20th century. Who are some of your favorite unsung women of classic television? Shout them out in the comments. Stay tuned for more here at Female Gaze Productions as we look at classic popular culture through a historical and feminist lens. My name is Kim. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at GazeFemale. That's G-A-Z-E female. And as always, if you like what you're seeing, please like and subscribe. Thanks, guys.